in the jungle, Nick in the mid lane, and the duo of Genja and Edward.
And on the red side for this match, it is Millenium. Kevin up top, Cotnex in the jungle, Kurt playing the mid lane, Kriatin on AD carry, and Jayri playing the support.
Well, before we get to champion select, let's see how you guys called this game. According to lolesports.com, 54% of you voted for Gambit.
Still very close. Millenium have been better on average over the last 9 games, but Gambit looked... Actually, both of these teams looked great yesterday. It's going to be an interesting one to see how it plays out.
So, as we move towards champion select, and let's talk about which champions we can expect to see banned out here and who's going to be picked. Mid lane's going to be a big thing.
This is a tough one, a really tough one. But I think Millenium are going to ban Braum and Kassadin. You know, I don't know where I'm getting that from, but I'm pretty confident. Nidalee has to be a consideration. Nick did a very, very good job on his Nidalee yesterday. Mm. Landed some very key spears. And I also think Lucian is going to be a priority. Kriatin's played him 6 times. Genja's played him 5 times. So definite focus on Lucian as the primary go-to AD carry. But we have seen Kriatin playing the likes of Twitch, the likes of Kog'Maw. So he has a wider diversity, whereas Genji's been focusing on that. Lucian and Caitlyn.
And seeing Jinx in that last game for the first time in this split as well. May add that into the split, whether with just Selva that's been practicing as much on Jinx. We'll have to see, because we're going to move into champion select, figure out exactly what will be banned and picked from both Gambit and Millenium. Gambit, of course, on the blue side, have first pick, first ban, and they've already taken out 2 quick bans, taking away LeBlanc from Kerp and Twitch from Kriatin. Other side, Kassadin ban, a Jax ban as well, and there's Ziggs taken away. We know how dangerous Kerp is on Ziggs. He's performed brilliantly on that champion. Will Braum be the final ban here for Millenium, or is he gonna get through?
I sincerely hope not, and I would love to see the moustache in the LCS. It was used by Voidal in NIP and, you know, managed to rack up 2 wins. I think, you know, junglers are getting a bit of a freebie today, considering there's only really 3 top-level LCS junglers available. We need to see what happens. It is happening, potentially.
Kale taken away, which means Braum is available here. Who's going to pick it? Is anyone going to pick it even? What we know, though, is that Gambit will prioritize Lucian, as you said before, taking that for Genja here on their first pick. So, for Millenium, will they take anything different? We've got 2 support players here that both have played weird supports in the past. Let's not forget Jayri, pretty much the only one playing Blitzcrank and Zillion, to name just a couple. Edward, he's been all over the place in the past couple of years with Kennen. What he's brought in. Kennen in the support role, playing Gragas most recently in there as well. But we'll have to see how that one all works out. I think there's going to be higher priority picks in these early couple of stages. Oh no,
we got him!
Going to get locked in here for Millenium as their first choice, along with Lee Sin. Glad I didn't make the mustache bet today.
So, the heart of the Freljord, he has been locked in. This is the first game we're going to see him. I'm incredibly excited about the mechanics of playing Braum in lane. We'll get to the details later, but generally, he is primarily a defensive support with great knockup potential. Yasuo is also available. So when you pair Braum with Yasuo, it is a scary combination. Consider that both Braum and Lee Sin could help get that last breath available. And we know Kerp likes to play assassins. Kerp has played Fizz in the past to great success. If he wants to get his hands on Yasuo, there's a massive amount of natural synergy. And if Shyvana is not locked in now by Gambit, you could even put Shyvana in the top lane and have a bajillion ways to activate Yasuo's ultimate. I'm a little excited by this, I think you can tell, and we need to see how the rest of the picks and bans plays out.
Well, let's keep it calm for now and see how that all goes down. What we do know for Gambit is that they've locked in Twisted Fate for Nick in the mid lane. We'll also see Diamond playing Evelynn this time around. So 2 out of the 3 jungle pool that we really have now on board have been taken in this game. And that Twisted Fate, and we'll see how Nick does moving around the map with that one after Kerp's brilliant Twisted Fate performance picked up the win for Millenium against the Super Hot Crew yesterday. So what are Millenium going to go with here? They could pick the mid laner now. AD carry also, I mean, they've already got Lucian on the Gambit side, so no real rush to get that one in.
There's not a real rush, and I really think Kevin is showing a massive preference to this Irelia. He's been playing Irelia over many other champions. He's currently 3-for-3 on this particular champion. And it makes me wonder, what is Kerb going to play in this middle lane? Because you've got a lot of burst damage from Graves. You have dashes from both Lee Sin and Irelia, and Braum can actually jump into the middle of a fight as well. And you've got a lot of CC as well as damage from multiple sources on the Millennium side. But Gambit have got the makings of a pick composition. With Evelynn that can come in unseen and Twisted Fate that's going to be able to surprise you very quickly with the Destiny, they may want to lock in champions that can aid that type of play, that can jump on somebody and kill them very quickly. I'm not believing what we're seeing right now.
No, Quinn, Malphite, probably not going to be the two champions that they end up locking in. These two, however, could be real possibility. Thresh for Edward, maybe, and then Aatrox for Darian in that top lane. We've seen Darian play Aatrox before, and we went back to that point of it kind of fits his style. He gets a second chance of staying alive when he sometimes gets called out of position, let's put it, as Aatrox will actually be locked in here then for the top lane for Darian. So Aatrox versus Irelia and the Thresh for Edward. We'll see if he can return to his glory days of the Thresh Prince.
Been a long time since he's been at that same level of dominance on Thresh. And Thresh is a champion that can do very well against Brahma in the early stages of the game. Up until level 6, his ranged ability and the flay on hit damage will do a lot to help keep Brahma at a low HP. If Gambit are going to look for that 2v2 lane, I'm not sure if they want to. They may want to do a lane swap. And like we talked about, the aggressive assassin has been locked in for Kirk. I personally would have liked to have seen a Yasuo just because of the synergy in the Wombo combo, but Kerb is played and won with Fizz. It is also a champion that can destroy a Twisted Fate. If Kerb gets ahead early, he will insta-give Nick at every opportunity he has. What Millennium are going to be looking for, though, is finding picks, killing a member of Gambit, and then using a numbers advantage to win the rest of the team fight. The only reliable CC is coming from Braum and that Glacial Fissure. Once Gambit pile on, he's going to knock them up. And if Millennium don't have proper targeting with their champions, I think they could be in a lot of trouble because Irelia and Evelynn can run amok in those team fights.
And we saw the stats for Fizz so far. They split 1-for-1, both games, of course, from Kerb, where he had one great game and one game where he probably just wants to forget going 0-5 and not really having fun with that one. But guys, which comp do you think is going to win out? Tweet at LOL Esports with hashtag GMBWin or #MILWin, and we'll see if those picks have changed your vote. Got a feeling that you might just be voting because Brown's been picked up for Millennium.
I would be. The moustache definitely tickles my interest, so we need to see how effectively Jayri can play this champion. It is patch 4.9, so his numbers have been tweaked since release. Damage on the Q and the tankiness from his W have been reduced, and we'll get to each of the abilities in-game. I really like to break down the specifics of the mechanics for those that haven't seen him, but we need to see them first in-game. So for our spectators, make sure we watch these duo lanes.
Yeah, I was going to spend a lot of time washing the Tash down in that bottom lane, or in the top lane, wherever he may be. But we are going to get into game, guys. It's Gambit taking on Millennium. And the first time here in the European LCS that we are going to be seeing Braum in action, picked up by Jayri this time around. Gambit, of course, banned him yesterday, so we'll see if not banning him here today will be a little bit of a mistake for them or not.
So very quickly, Graves and Braum are going to give a lot of defensive statistics in terms of bonus armor and magic resist. Thanks to Braum's W, stand behind me. He's going to dash to an ally, and he's going to give them bonus armor and MR. And you combine that with Graves' passive of that True Grit. When Evelynn and Aatrox jump onto them in a team fight, they're going to be much tankier than your standard AD carry and support lane. And that is the best picture-in-picture we've ever had.
I was going to say, we've got a special Braum dance cam going on in the bottom left-hand corner there. Not sure we'll keep that up for the entire game, but we'll have to see how much time we'll be focusing on that duo of Millennium. One thing I do know, Creighton had a fantastic performance yesterday, and sadly for me, since I'm playing Jat in Fantasy this week, who has Creighton, just from that one player is pretty much destroying me up until now. So we'll see how that one goes. Gambit, in the meantime, have stacked Diamond and Edward. Are they going to go for a blind hook and catch themselves a Braum for breakfast?
It looks like they want to. There's not a lot of damage to back it up, though. Without Genja being nearby, it's not going to play in his favor. So Braum, he's already skilled his Winter's Bite. It's the Q. Long-range skill shot. It applies a slow to the targeted hits, and look for the passive. He's going to catch Genja with it, I'll bet you money. And if you manage to get all four of those procs from Braum's passive, you will stun a target, and anyone can activate them. So what I want to see is how effectively Millennium focus the stun down, because at max rank, it'll be a 1.7 second stun, and we'll see if Millennium can focus the target and get the kills. It will help them. But immediately, they're on the back foot. They've lost their blue buff.
lost the blue buff, and we see here that we are going to be looking at that 2v2 duo head up in the bottom lane with Creighton's Graves and Jayreez Brown against the Lucian Thresh of Genja and Edward. Interested to see how that one all works out. Also interested to see how Darien plays this game. Now that it's solo lanes, he's going to go straight into the top lane.
Yeah, and he may be able to feed to provide dragons, as Diamond was so happy to point out yesterday in the interview. On this Aatrox, he's also going to have... He's actually got a very good champion that will help Gambit in teamfights against this very high quasi-assassin build, because Millenium want to be focusing down individual targets, and if they focus Aatrox down, he can just come back to life.
Not as many Brown fans as I first believed here. 54% to 46% still in favor of Gambit Gaming, so not much of a change really when it comes to what you guys at home are thinking this game is gonna go like.
And note just how passive both Creighton and Jayreez are playing at this level one. They do have a lane matchup that should theoretically lose in trades to Edward and Genja, because Genja's going to get those multi-shots off from his passive. Oh, Cartnex finds Diamond. Going to trade some damage.
They're going to trade some, well, trade some damage might be the wrong word here. Diamond is going to hammer away at Cartnex. Red buff for both of them. And I tell you what, Cartnex needs to be a little bit careful. Kerp is coming around the corner. Cartnex needs to be careful how deep he goes on this one, though. And here we see it. Kerp going to go right in on towards Diamond. Twisted Fate is there. Gold card and wild cards come down. But Diamond falling low. He's going to flash. Meho Lee Sin comes in. Managed to secure the kill. Nicholas flash through. Cartnex following him. Cartnex going low. He will flash away. Kerp flashes back in, and now they've caught Edward. It's a good flay coming out, but I think the damage might be too much. No, he's made enough distance there to get away, and that will leave Millenium with two kills. Disastrous for Gambit.
Overconfidence on the side of Diamond. He didn't have the full support of the rest of his team. He gets caught out, and Millenium are able to land two very quick kills. More importantly, is one of them is in Kerp's back pocket. Because of the fact that he wants to be ahead and he needs to have items as quickly as possible. Oh, they've caught Jayreez.
And Flay gonna come in there, but I'm not sure they got enough damage to put him down, but still, damage is damage. A good trade there for Gambit in this bottom lane, and I could do with a couple of good trades at this point. This top lane, which has been fairly quiet so far, Darien actually ahead slightly on the CS at 28 to 22. And now Diamond coming across. Cartnex already there, and actually not quite going to spot Diamond out. Actually, that's probably a lag. He's just thrown the Q straight his way. Diamond just heading him off, so no real action to be had on this top side.
No, not this time around. It did look like Diamond was trying to find a way to get into that matchup, was unable to do so. So, double Doran's Rings picked up for Kerp. This is going to give him a very nice power spike, in addition to having that flask. So he's got more sustain than Nick. But again, we need to see how quickly Kerp can start finding those kills and roaming around the map. What we have noticed is Creighton is falling very far behind in CS. He was left alone because Jayreez went to roam and help out in the jungle, did not pick up any assists. And the lane matchup does very badly against Threshers because of the fact that Brahm is melee. So he's not going to have the ability to really punish Genja or Edward. Once Jayreez gets to level 6, he does have some kill potential with his ultimate, that Glacial Fissure. And Diamond is sniffing around mid.
Speaking of fissures, there is a stun going towards Kerp, but he actually dodges most of that damage and is actually going to put some back towards Diamond, who comes in. Lee Sin was waiting off to the side. And as you mentioned, Kerp, not a champion, not a player, and not a champion even this time around with Fizz that you want to let get going. Currently 1-0-1 after those kills before. Creighton also, we heard the low health ping down in the bottom lane. He is running almost on empty at this point. Need to be very careful about how they handle this bottom lane matchup still.
Yeah, gotta be so, so careful. Creighton and Jayreez need to survive until 6 and get some assistance from Cartnex or from Kerp. Either of them can come down. Hell, Kevin could even teleport in. And if you combine, you know, any one of them plus the slow and the stun that Jayreez is going to offer with Brown, there is a definite amount of kill potential. I feel like Diamond is spending a lot of time trying to fight ganks, but he's ahead. Jerry's jumped in.
Oh, Jayreez has jumped in there. Diamond will show himself. Cartnex is there. Creighton's still pretty low, as we are going to see the hook come down. Edward falling low himself. Cartnex, though, didn't have the health to actually follow through and pick them up and kill. Meanwhile, Darien going to lose his blood well. Not much help there to be regen, but Kevin doesn't want to follow through. He used a hell of a lot there, and actually we see the teleport from Kevin was interrupted.
Yeah, we do see that, Kevin. I'm going to hazard a guess that he teleported back to lane and instantly went aggressive on Darien because he does have that sheen. So I think that was the way it played out. I do want to quickly go back to that Jayreez initiation. You notice he jumped to a minion. His stand behind me can be used to dash to minions as well. So get in range, land that Winter's Bite from the Q, and look for a stun. His big shield, the Unbreakable, will also mitigate the 100% of the damage from the first projectile that connects with it. That's excluding turret shots, which means, and then everything else, it's damage reduction, which means that Unbreakable can counter the culling very, very, very effectively, assuming Jerry's in the right place at the right time.
Very interesting start to this one. Darien actually coming back into lane. Apparently he's been talking a lot to Genja before this game because he come back with the triple Doran's Blade up against Kevin. Wants a bit of power now after Kevin TP'd back into lane with that Sheen and went instantly aggressive on him. We heard in the video before the match that Kevin said, love playing against Darien. Doesn't matter whether he's ahead or behind, he's always aggressive, always going ham, and I think that Kevin trying to dish out a bit of his own medicine there.
One of the things that's interesting about Darien is it doesn't matter how many times he dies, he's almost always even on CS with his lane opponent. Whether or not it's ahead or behind league averages, which is what we talked about earlier, he does tend to farm well in his respective matchups, and he's doing it again now. He was under pressure from Kevin, he's returned with this instant power spike, and with three Dorans and his passive on the W, he's gonna get a lot of HP back on auto attack, so we'll see if the sustain helps him out.
Genja also being quite aggressive down bottom. Again, bit of damage coming in. See 73 to 52 CS, and that's allowed Genja to get a BF sword compared to the Vamp Scepter actually on the other side for Creighton. So a bit more sustain in there for Creighton, but raw power in favor of Genja. And probably means that Cortex is going to have to spend some time around this bottom lane, and almost worked out for them a little bit earlier on.
So Jerry's getting much closer to level 6. You'll notice Creighton has got access to his collateral damage. So this is the time for the teleports to come in, and Jerry's actually started a fight, maybe a little early.
Got a little bit far on this one, a lot of damage coming in. Twisted Fate ultimate is going to be popped, but where's he going? What's Nick going to do with this one? He's going nowhere. It gives them vision, at least I suppose, of where Cotton X was for that one, but no follow through. First Destiny of the game, going to go almost unused.
That is a very, very big swing for Millenium. It allows them to now make a play in this bottom lane with Kevin's teleport, which will be up soon, or with Cortex, without fear of having Twisted Fate interrupt. So they need to be aware of it. Jerry does have access to his Glacial Fish, and here comes Diamond.
Oh, this is bad news for them. Diamond coming in. There is the ultimate coming down from Jerry, but he's finished off by Genja. A nice kill back here from Cortex. Gambit. They do have Lee Sin moving around the back, but is Cortex comfortable enough with this one? Do they think they can get anything? Is he just waiting for Fizz to move down? He was pinged out. No further action there.
So a lot of people talking about the power of Braum, and Braum means victories, and he's banned in scrims and ranked. If you play with a coordinated Thresh, ooh, that was very close, you can actually shut him down in lane. Genja and Edward have done a very good job of keeping him on the back foot. Look at Kerb, throws out the Chum the Waters, and that could have been a dead nick.
Especially since Cornex, don't even know how he got there, went round to the water thinking around the back of the race, came walking up from the opposite side of the map. Nick though staying safe for now on that one, has fallen a bit behind in CS, and of course with his one death and Kurt being 1-0-1 as well, is behind on items and everything and that lane offers to him. Meanwhile, Kevin now coming back into lane with a little bit more using his teleport. Is he going to go insta-aggressive? He is. Darien, however, this time he's able to just jump away, does have his Bloodwell passive available again, so he's back to somewhat safety.
Yeah, going to be able to have that margin for error, I think is the term. Jerry gets hooked, but got no ultimate available, so finally playing a little more aggressively. He's had that Sightstone for a few minutes now, which is going to give him some HP, and the reason that's very important is the damage from his Winter's Bite in the Q actually stacks with a percentage of his HP, and because he gets bonus armor and magic resist, it makes his effective hit points much more effective. And we do see Kirby's looking too aggressive, but no ultimate yet.
No ultimate available for him means probably no kill. I'm just going to bully Nick a little bit out of that lane. His ultimate, by the way, Destiny, will be coming off cooldown here in just a short while. Meanwhile, Creighton and Jerry got a brief respite down in bottom because both Genja and Edward did recall. However, that's not going to last too long. Genja's going to come back to lane with Bloodthirster done. We'll see if Creighton's actually got the gold. Doesn't quite have the gold, actually, just yet for a BF sword. So he's real behind when it comes to itemization there.
Yeah, 20 CS is effectively a kill at this stage in the game. And not only is Creatine behind, but Cotton X is falling a large amount of CS behind Diamond as well. Diamond is farming up an absolute storm on Evelynn. And if you consider the number of times he's been present in lanes, barring his over-aggressive start to the match, he's actually had a lot of pressure applied, and he's making Millenium at least consider and think about where he might be. So we do see Diamond roaming to the top lane. Kevin's got Flash and his ultimate. I think they're going to go for that now.
I think he's going to need it because we got Twisted Fate moving towards the top as well. There's the gold card. Kevin here in all kinds of trouble. Won't be able to take down Darian's passive. And that is another kill in the back for Millenium. However, for Gambit, Millenium with that numbers advantage now on the bottom side of the map going to be going in towards Dragon. However, Genjin is still there.
Here comes Genjin. Culling's up.
Culling's up, but we see how effective Brown is at blocking that one. They get the knock-up onto Edward, but Jayri is going to go down. Edward knocked up in the air by the fish. This will surely be a kill back for Millenium. It's Kurt that gets that one. Genja trying to get away. Here comes Darian. Creatine's going to fall. Connex as low. That's a double kill for Genja. Can they actually get Kurt here? Genja trying to lifesteal a little bit back, but the presence of Darian offering them a lot there. The dragon didn't go down, and that means that Gambit come out so, so strong in that fight.
Very, very good fight for them. They end up trading 3-1 once all is told and done. Because Kevin died in the top lane, they gave up two more around the Dragon Pit. Genja is now 4-0-0. He was in a lane matchup that he was already winning thanks to the range advantage over Braum. And I just think very smart play. Millenium tried to rush Dragon down, but Kerp and Cotton X, they are looking for the objective. They weren't looking for the team fight. So once Jayri had initiated that, the rest of the team weren't on the same page. Spent so much time trying to focus down Edward that with that Bloodthirster, the damage and the combat advantage that Genji had was just, it was too much to overcome. And it's allowed Gambit now the potential of this dragon.
Genja continuing to show that he's maybe got what it takes to constantly carry them through as they manage the hook onto Jayri. Follow through, doesn't get the knock up, but there's a lot of damage to go Jayri's way. His shield blocking a lot of that, but now the TP coming down. Darian caught in no man's land. Genja going to be locked up by Creatine and Jayri and finished off. It's a kill for Brown, but look at Darian. Continues to go heavy, but he's lost his passive and he's going to go down to Kevin. That's a double kill for Irelia, and now they keep going. The fish thrown out. Earth's going to come through. Have they got the damage for Edwin as well? The slow from Kevin will lock that one up, and it's Creatine to get another. And despite Gambit's great fight before, we now see a 4-1 in Millennium's favor.
Millennium are back in the game. This dragon is going to even up that gold by a very large amount. The killing spree bonus that Genja had accrued ends up going to Jayri, which is not necessarily ideal, but they managed to get it on their side regardless. It's 1,000 gold that separates them, and that all stems from Gambit being overconfident, from not evaluating or thinking about the options. Four members of Millennium were close by, and you know, Gambit may not have had full vision on the likes of Cotton X or Kerp until later on, but look how deep they chase. And then they're split. Genja goes down the lane, the rest of the team is split off to the left. Communication and teamwork there, not the strongest. And all props to Millennium. That's a great kick from Cotton X as well. I think Millennium just did a good job of focusing whoever was closest and managing to secure the kills.
That fight all happening without Kerb using his ultimate until these last very few moments to lock up and secure the kill onto Edward. Only Nick survives that fight, so really, really well played by Millennium. It's going to give Gambit a little bit of food for thought, I think, now as to how they play the rest of these, or these next few minutes, certainly, in this matchup. If we look at towers, it's 2-0 for Gambit, taking out that mid one earlier, thanks to Nick as a hook comes through, but there's no follow-up there from the rest of Gambit.
Nobody to keep up with him just yet. Just a quick update for those that are interested in Braum. Jayri is actually maxing his Q first, and he's got 2 points into his E at this stage in time. So going for Winter's Bite and then Unbreakable. Of course, the big shield, it does scale with percentage damage reduction with the more points you put into it. Look how aggressive Jayri's playing. Gold card in the mid lane. They're going for Nick.
Yeah, he's dead. Kerm actually going to get that one with the Ignite. Easy finisher for him. Can they get in on towards Genja? The knockup will come through thanks to JRE, but with Diamond now there, this could be a real problem. Edward steps forward, but they turn around, put all the focus onto Edward, and Kerm will get in and gets himself onto the rampage. Meanwhile, Connex and Kevin now coming through. They're going to go for Diamond. Slow it down, but have they got the damage? They do now. Kevin's there, and he gets the kill onto Genja. Diamond going to be headed up on the other side, and this is going to be an ace for Millenium.
Millenium just roam and find the targets they want. They jumped onto Nick just off camera, managed to blow him up, and as Gambit was scrambling to defend, the single target mobility that Millenium has, every single champion has some form of movement spell that they can move around. I mean, Kevin and Kotsenik were focusing down Darien while the rest of the fight was happening in the mid lane. Millenium have got such a great skirmish, you know, 2v2, 2v3 type of champions, and they're making full use of it because Gambit have been caught out, split up, and they're going down.
You see there, once again, the chasing power with Brown. He not only offers a lot, or much Tash, you could say, but also much CC to be added in. I'm sorry, I've been saving that one for a while. But really chasing down well after what was a bit of a ropey start for JRE down there. These last couple of fights really coming out big, blocking a lot of that damage that comes through. And in the end, it leaves Millenium now with close to a 2,000 gold lead.
I was really happy with how JRE positioned himself moving into the river. His shield blocked every single shot of the culling from Genja. And it's just a massive amount of damage reduction to really reduce the effectiveness of that champion. Unfortunately, Millenium out of position to defend their last outer turret, but they're ahead in gold. They've got that dragon from earlier on. They've got twice the number of kills of Gambit, and they still haven't secured a tower. So if and when Millenium do start pushing the map, which is what really matters, that's when they're going to accelerate much further ahead. That's a Lich Bane already completed on Kerb, so he can potentially drop towers quickly.
Oh, Twisted Fate's going to join in this one. Where is Kerb going to go? He's actually going to go deep for Genja. He gets the ultimate off, but I don't think he's got the damage to get through. He will fall here. The shutdown will fall onto Diamond.
So Diamond's going to get the bonus gold. I think Kerb with a little bit of an odd flash. I'm not sure if he hit the turret when he tried to chase Genja down. Regardless, he gets dropped. It looks like the rest of Millenium are getting some good damage on the mid turret, and I still think that's a trade they'll be fairly happy with. Pulled a lot of members from Gambit down. They know Destiny's not available, which means once Chumba Waters is up, they can go again. Darien's the next target.
Darien is going to be in trouble here. Does have his passive available, but is that going to save him? They actually kick him out pretty much of the turret range. He will jump through, but he'll be chased on. And it's Cotton X that gets that one. Kevin helping out nicely, but this turret is going down. JRE had just come across. That won't really make any difference in things. Nicely done by Millenium. 13-7 up in kills now. 2,000 gold is the lead.
Yeah, and that all, again, reduced the threat of that Destiny, and then you can continue pushing elsewhere on the map. Kerb, I think, is going to be working towards a Zhonya's Hourglass at some point. Maybe a Death Cap is his next item with this Blasting Wand. But once he does get that Hourglass, it's going to just allow him to run amok in team fights. Dash all the way in, dodge the gold card with his Playful Trickster or the Zhonya's Hourglass. And as Gambit are scrambling to find a target, you're going to have Irelia, Lee Sin, Graves, and Braum all dashing around in the team fight. So while it's important for Millenium to stick to the same target to kill them, it's also very difficult for Gambit to lock Millenium down. They've got single target CC, which is great, but there's five champions that can dash and dodge and dip and duck and dive, so it's going to be difficult for them.
They can lock anyone down. We do see Turi actually fall in there, which brings Millenium back to 3-3. So all outer towers on the map are now down. The question is who's going to start making the moves for these inner turrets. Dragon, of course, will be coming up in just over a minute's time. You have to feel that that's probably going to be the next port of call for both of these teams.
Yeah, and Gambit need to be careful. If they want to initiate, they need to do it fast, and they need to catch Millenium off guard. If Gambit give Millenium the chance to initiate first by diving onto the right target or using that Fizz ultimate, then Millenium can just insta-give somebody and instantly have the Dragon be a much safer position. So it does look like that dragon has respawned, and we will be seeing whether or not Gambit can actually initiate quickly enough, because teleport is available from Kevin. Destiny's being used from Nick. He's going top lane, Dragon for Millennium.
Diamond trying to save that one, but that one will help out. Meanwhile, Kevin actually caught by both Nick and Darian. He flashes, but there's two flashes coming in, gets stunned up, and that will surely be the finisher. It is Darian that actually gets the shutdown onto Kevin. But look at this, Millennium hunting for a couple of kills down bottom. They don't get it, but they did get that Dragon. As I said before, there's the hook onto Cotton X. Actually, Edwin gonna get slowed down. That's a good play, but now with Creatine coming in, this could be real dangerous. A good block of the Cullen. Edward locked up and finished off. He put the box down. Cotton X just stands in the middle and says, I'll just wait it out.
That was the perfect example of how powerful Braum's passive of concussive blows is. He landed onto Edward. Edward flashed away, and the last few auto attacks from Creatine stunned him. Because he was stunned, the rest of the team could pick that kill up. So they end up trading one kill for one, Edward for Kevin. Kevin burns one flash for both Nick and Darian's flash, as well as Nick's Destiny and Exhaust. So even though Kevin went down and gave up a kill and an assist, he gets more summoner spells and an ultimate out of the deal, which means Millennium come out very far ahead in that trade as long as they can take advantage of that situation. So smart play. Millennium are continuing to accelerate their control, and they're just in a good place. Kerp actually finished a Void Staff as his second item. Not amassing huge amounts of ability power yet, but he'll get there, I'm sure. 514 is doing a good job.
And already able to do big damage either way. See that Brown very tanky at this point, actually picking up a Negatron cloak there. On the other side, Edward actually got the Chains Vest, got a Giant's Belt as well, so see where he's heading with that towards the Randuins by the looks of things. Meanwhile, Millennium already starting to clear out and have a lot of pink wards. Look at the pink wards on the map here for Millennium. One thing is, of course, the complete vision control and the ability to sweep out those wards, but also to keep an eye on the sneaky Evelynn, who could be up in their jungle, getting wards of his own down.
Been doing a very good job of dealing with Diamond's Evelynn, even with the amount of presence and attempted ganks from Diamond. Millennium didn't lose complete control of the game, and then they punished Gambit when Gambit were over-aggressive. So Millennium have hit some very big power spikes and items. Randuins and Triforce for Kevin, like you talked about. Oh, Darren, let's see if he can get away.
Well, that is a lot of damage coming his way. However, look at the lifesteal back here for Darian. Ignite is ticking away, and that will be a bit of a problem for him. Does get the slow. No, it doesn't. Kurt will dash straight onto him. But now, has he got the damage to finish off? There is the Blade of the Ruin King being used by Darian. But Kurt's still going to be able to chase. His cooldowns will be coming up here shortly. Darian is going to do a lot of damage as Diamond gets caught on the top side of the map. There's a Cully coming through, and again we see the Brown blocking out most, if not all, of that damage.
Very, very well played by Jayri. Unfortunate for Kerb to not find the kill onto Darian, but I really like the fact that Kerb is willing to flash over those dashes. Oh, they caught Genja.
They caught Genja, what happened? Yeah, they do. They got the damage. Oh, summoner heal coming out, and there is the Destiny pot, which sends Millennium running, sends them scattering on this top side of the map, and somehow Genja gets away with that one. The use of his summoner heal did have flash available as well, should he really be called into that one, but stayed alive. Pretty much, I think the Destiny was the scary part for Millennium there.
The mobility on the side of Millennium is just so, so difficult for Gambit to deal with. They've got a lot of movement themselves and dashes. There's a lot of champions that can move very quickly, but Millennium in that situation, you've seen how instantly they thwarted the power of Destiny. Nick couldn't even get in range to auto-attack because of how quickly Cotton X was moving to the rest of his team. So we were, you know, there's a lot of drama happening. Darian forced to burn his ultimate, his passive rather, because of the fact that Kerb jumped on him. But that is a scary sign when Darian is arguably meant to be one of the tankiest members. He hasn't even finished his Randian's Omen yet.
Oh,
round two.
Round two. Without a passive, and boom, there's a fish in your face, and ultimate miss completely, and now Darian is maybe gonna still go down. I always somehow underestimate that damage if you can get a second combo off there from Kerb. Despite missing the ultimate, picked up his sixth kill.
I love the little shrug from Kerb's shoulders, like, meh, didn't need the fish. I got this, bro. But I mean, he was 5-1-4 going into it, so much damage to deal with, and Darian has not itemized any MR. He's got Ninja Tabi, and a Warden's Mail. So there's no magic resist to thwart Kerb. So unfortunate for Darian, but he's still doing fairly well in the CS regards. And, you know, if you look down the items, two Randian's Omens for Millennium. So not only are they mobile, they can deny the movement speed from their opponents with those actives. And with all the penetration that Kerb and Creatine have built up, their burst damage combos will be more effective at this stage in the game, and they're making it work for them.
I've got this yo. I don't think it's something that will ever come out of Kurt's mouth, to be honest, but whatever. He manages to get that kill, and he's building himself up towards that Zhonya's Hourglass, which will give him a little bit more safety. Also, have the Zhonya's already done over the other side for Nick, along with his Athenes, and a second needlessly large rod is going to be picked up on that front. We see the difference between the AD carries as well. Creighton, Bloodthirst at Last Whisper, and then into attack speed. On the other side, Genja picking up the Static Shiv as his second item after the Bloodthirst.
Yeah, very important for Creighton to go for that Last Whisper because of how important Graves' burst damage is. He needs to get Buckshot and Collateral damage to melt through Gambit's HP. And when he combines that with the Assassination and the single target focus that Lee Sin and Irelia have, it allows them to instantly remove people from the team fight. It's how Millennium will want to continue playing this game. Focus single targets down with their champions who do very well at shutting them down. And with Dragon coming up very, very soon, it looks like Millennium are playing the baiting game. Look for a Glacial Fissure from Jerry. I think he may want to start this off.
Well, Dragon has now come into play. Let's see. Q from Cotton X will start proceedings off. Diamond and the rest of Gambit, not sure how much they want to try and fight for this one. In fact, it looks like they're going to try and play make a play on the mid lane here. Dragon does go Millennium's way, the third of the game that they pick up, and I'm not sure that Gambit are fast enough to really do anything about this. In fact, Millennium may even be looking to chase.
What I'd love to see from Millennium is Captain Boots on one of their team members, maybe even Kerb, who's going to be on the front line. If Millennium had been able to run down Gambit, they could have started a fight. Millennium now have better positioning on the inner turret, and with the zone control and the threat that Kerb's ultimate and Braum's ultimate will offer, it should give Millennium some time in this tower. Unfortunately, they don't have any minions to back them up, and it looks like they're playing it a little safe.
Kevin tanked a couple of hits, and I think was like, come on, guys, hit the turret. I'm tanking this one up, but there was no real follow-up. A little bit of danger maybe came from the fact that they've got no real vision on the blue side of Gambit's jungle. Speaking of that blue side, Nick will get himself the buff once again. So as teams back off, we're about to hit the half an hour point in this game. We'll see if it becomes a halfway point, who knows. 15-8, Millennium leading kills, a solid 4,000 gold lead, and it's 3-3 in towers. But that, we just seen you on your screen there, the Danger Man, Kerb, 6-1-4 with Fizz.
So Millennium have got a relatively unsafe wave clear. You know, the range on Graves is very short. Irelia's ultimate has a fairly lengthy cooldown. So if Gambit ever get themselves into a position where they can siege up against Millennium, the power of Twisted Fate in that situation can be very good. What it also means is Millennium have a difficult time sieging. So in order for Millennium to take these inner turrets, they are forced to do the same. They have the same problems to deal with that Fnatic had yesterday. They need to get vision control, they need to surprise people, or they need to find picks.
Oh, they get the slowdown onto Edward, but no real follow-up there. Darien was playing the risky game of clearing the wards at the back of the Baron pit. Did take the Lantern out to safety, but a close call. Millennium looking for a almost free kill there if they'd have been able to lock up one of them. However, they have full presence around that Baron area. We see using those sweeping lenses, four of them that Millennium currently have. Only Creighton, in fact, doesn't have a sweeping lens right now. And Millennium know that they've got a stronghold on that area. However, there's two wards still for Gambit just outside of the Baron pit itself. So I think Millennium not got as much control as they'd maybe like to believe.
No, very, very important. And they're not even going to notice that ward just outside the pit either. Now, Millennium and Gambit have got a lot of damage on both of their sides. So a Baron bait could be very important. And so unfortunate for Millennium, they don't know that Gambit knows they're not going for Baron. They're trying to bait it out. And Gambit aren't falling for it.
Oh, you say that.
Oof. Don't make me eat my words. Don't make me eat my words.
Good thing is,
keeping vision, he's playing a human ward.
Ah, there we go. Scan coming down, and Millennium saying, nope, need to move away because Genja's actually pushed up that mid lane. Meanwhile, Millennium now come out of the brush and kind of just run around in circles a little bit there. And like, what are we doing? Are we pushing? Are we going back here? What are we doing?
Gambit are too scared to siege because they're behind, and they're afraid if they get caught from the sidelines by Fizz or by Irelia, they're going to lose members and lose the fight. Millennium don't have the tools to siege, so they can't sit underneath the tower because Twisted Fate's wave clear is very high, and they run the risk of being flanked by Evelynn or Aatrox. So in order for either of these teams to actually get an advantage. It needs a misplay from their opponents, or it needs Millenium actually tower diving or forcing Gambit's hand. Millenium tried to do it at Baron. They just missed some crucial vision. And I think we may see the Dragon slash Baron dance to determine who's going to have the next leg up in this game.
So, you know, Ward put around the corner will be spotted going down from Millennium's side. So they know exactly where they've got to scan to clear that one out. Diamond also having a bit of run around, seeing what he can spot out. And we'll see Kerp and Cotonex moving down from the red buff area. That red buff just going over to Cotonex. And look at that, Gambit saying, no, we don't want a piece of this one. Just going to back straight away from it.
So Gambit are still keeping up mostly as far as the gold is concerned, considering that Millenium have had the Dragon control and considering they've got 7 kills and a whole bunch of assists under their belt. Their CS is still good. Genji in particular has got way more CS than Creator. Almost something happening, but really just tentative. So for Gambit, they just need to be very, very wary. If they do start a fight, it has to be Diamond or Darien on that front line. And they can't afford to let the burst damage of Graves and Fizz hit the squishies of Gambit. If that happens, that's an instant team fight victory for Millennium.
Here we go then. Push on towards that turret in the bottom lane. Inner tower going to take a lot of damage, and I don't think they can hold this one. That's a nice move from Millennium. Moving 4 men to the bottom lane. Irelia was just inside of the jungle, and that will be the 4th tower of the game for Millennium. The first inner turret to go down on this map. Very important there. That may just open the floodgates for Millennium to work a bit more magic on the others. However, Gambit pushing out here towards Barrett.
Floodgates, I think, is a little overzealous there, Joe. I think it'll open
spring the... Spring a leak.
It'll spring a leak in Gambit's defensive dam. I think that's a better way to look at it. And as long as Nick is still standing, the power to wave clear is there. Also, Nick can actually respond with Destiny if he needs to. And I think it's quite smart that Nick didn't waste the ultimate for that inner turret on the bottom lane, because that's not a game-changing objective. Gambit already behind. They need to be careful. Look at the patience from Millennium. They had 3 members there that could have jumped onto Diamond, but they opted against it. They don't want to waste their ultimates or waste their initiation when their objectives like Dragon or Baron on the table. And this should be completely uncontested for Gambit.
Yeah, no one's going to come around this one. Like you said, a freebie for Millennium. Oh, compound their gold lead, moving up towards 6,000. See the numbers, 4 out of 4. That is pretty epic control so far for Millennium. And if you look back to yesterday's win for Gambit, it was all about their Dragon control that was able to keep them in the game and eventually turn the tides in their favor. So that's something they're lacking this time around. But as you mentioned, Millennium being very, very passive, very safe about how they handle this game. No risks.
They can't afford to, because their comp has no wave clear. So safe wave clear. So when Millennium do actually lose a team fight, it's so much more difficult for them to defend towers. And because Gambit are behind, they're not sneaking. So we've just got the stalemate situation that we've already touched on. And I think for Gambit, they've done a good job of keeping vision up in the Baron pit. But Nick on Twisted Fate has been far too passive for my liking. They've had opportunities where Nick could have looked for ganks, could have looked for, you know, the very first Destiny he used ended up being thwarted as a no-go just because Jerry and Creighton could back away quickly enough. And if you contrast that to Kerp yesterday, he was tower diving with that Twisted Fate. He would go under the towers and focus down Mr. Riles. Anyways, Millennium, the first brave move. They started with Baron. Vision is in their favor. Looks like he's going to peel this one away. Finally going to get that Lost Ward as well.
Curious. Gambit moving towards it, but not really in a position there where Millennium could have, I think, got any kind of opportunity. This, though, could be that opportunity. If they see Genji down on the bottom side of the map, gives them an instant 5 versus 4 scenario.
Not if, when, because it does look like Genji's going to shove that lane out. Gambit, I think, are doing a fairly good job, because what they can do is they can feign pushing for the inner turret. It looks like they're going to commit for the time being because they haven't peeled away, and this should be Baron for Millennium, and Gambit have just given this up. They're not contesting, they're not going for inner turret. I have no idea what the decision making is, because they've just given that up. That's a mistake.
Not a good call. And Darian's going to die here as well. Getting caught out. Fish knocks him up in the air. Will, of course, have his passive pop, but that'll be followed straight up from. It's Kurt that gets that kill. And now they're going to keep chasing here. It's Diamond, the next target. A lot of damage coming his way. There's a dive in from Connex. They kick Nick out. He uses a last second zone. Is that buying some time? But Kreaton able to finish that off. Gets himself the killing spree. Not only do they give up the Baron, they lose two men straight after it as well. For almost nothing.
No, for nothing. There was nothing to gain other than a bunch of CS on Genja. He immediately shown himself. The rest of Gambit did not commit to a strategic push in the mid lane, and they got completely outpositioned around Baron. This should be an inhibitor turret as well. There's so much damage. Kevin's gone in,
and they're going to focus Diamond. And that's the burst we were talking about earlier on, and it's been so prevalent here for Millenium. They're going to take the first inhibitor. There's 40 seconds on Diamond, 20 on Nick, 10 on Darian. A simple push to the top lane, and indeed, that's the one outside of the base that is left standing. It means that Gambit, after this little Millennium push, are probably only going to have their base left to work with.
And wow, Millennium aren't even going to face tank the turret, so going to push the minion wave right up to it. They've got so much tanky stats. This is just playing it super, super safe. And Millennium punish Gambit for poor decision.
No, Darian. See Hulk coming in. The ultimate off curve is still available. It's actually Cortnex and JRE that were keeping them moved and zoned away from that inner turret. In the end, looks like Millennium, as we've been seeing time and time again so far this match, that safety is the name of the game. No mistakes. Don't mess anything up with a lead this big, and they're going to go home, spend all the cash that they've earned after picking up that Baron and the kills.
Just a few big items being completed. Lee Sin grabbed himself some more defensive stats and Spectres. Kyle Graves grabbed himself an Infinity Edge. Aurelius picked up a Zephyr. We've got Locket of the Iron Solari as well as a Ruby Sidestone for JRE. So it's just the item difference is nearly insurmountable. And when Millennium can focus down any member of Gambit, they don't even need to initiate on the back line. They don't even need to initiate the squishy targets because they can get rid of Darian and then basically rush down whoever's left. You've seen how quickly they melted, was it Diamond under the tower? You know, all five members just piled on, landed on top of him and squashed him under their combined weight.
So let's see now, Millennium actually moving towards his bottom lane. Super minions will start to pressure Gambit's middle lane or the Nexus turrets eventually. As they work their way through, Kerp has cleared out bottom and the rest of the team moving a little bit deeper through that Gambit jungle to intercept the next wave of minions that's coming out of the base.
And it's so weird to contrast Gambit from yesterday, who had strategic play, who rotated around the map against Alliance and really did a good job of controlling the Dragon Pits and controlling the tempo of their pushes, to just give up a Baron because of a side lane CS for Genja. That's reminiscent of problems that we were seeing even last split, where Genja would be on the side lanes and it would cost important objectives in the late game. It's something that they'll need to go back and review. Anyways, Super Minions making it very close to that middle lane inhibitor steps. And you know what? Millennium could dive. If Kerp gets bored, he could just throw in that Chum the Waters and they can look to finish anyone. There's no passive for Darian either.
Kevin. Start things off. Kerp actually going to dive straight in there, and it's Darian that they focus on first. He will be absolutely destroyed. Nick down to half HP. Actually, JRE going to be hooked under the tower, and he will flash out of that one. Millennium taking a decent amount of damage. That Baron will help with the regen, and it's 50 seconds until Darian actually comes back in, and the mid lane is being pushed all the way through now. The super minions are onto the Nexus turrets, and that means that Millennium are going to get a second in him.
They're going to get this one. There's no one from Gambit that can hold him off. The question is, do Millennium fall back and play it safe, or do they want to contest more objectives? They do have the numbers advantage for another 30 seconds. Dragon is up though, and I think it looks like playing it safe. Safety is the name of the game here. Eight towers down, two inhibitors down, and everywhere Millennium go, kills are sure to follow.
And they're over the 10,000 gold lead here on Millennium, and they're going back with a decent amount of gold to spend across the board. We see Quicksilver Sash coming out. There's all kinds of different things being picked up now for Millennium. Banshee's Veil was complete for Kreaton as well. By the looks of it, they're just going to be gearing up until this next Baron comes into play, where, you know, if Gambit gave that last one up so free, there's no real way that they can contest for this next one.
No, there's no way they can contest for it anymore. They needed to have not done that. a few minutes ago. And Millenium don't even need the Baron because they've got such a big advantage and their initiation power is so much stronger and scarier than Gambit's. They're just going to brute force their way in. I think smart play from Millenium to wait from Creighton. There were only four members on the in here. And in order for Gambit to do anything, they need Diamond and Darian to get multi-man knockups and ultimates, and it's not going to work. Take a look at the burst.
Herb going in on towards Genja, uses the Zhonya's. Karnak's coming around the side as well. Nick trying to keep him away from that. Karnak's may go down, but they've killed off one. They've managed to take down Edwin. Diamond going to be ping-ponged around the team as he's kicked back by Kotonex. Darian may be getting in there. No, he's going to be blown up and forced to back away. Nick also at half health. They seem to have repelled Millenium for now by killing the jungler, but Millenium got the in-him on the way out.
One for one, Millennium's carries are still up. There's no more disengage from Edward, and there was no box available in that fight. Gambit are doing okay at holding off these sieges, but it's quite clear that Millenium are just throwing themselves at their opponents. They're looking for the objectives, taking advantage of the big lead that they've built up. Unfortunately, giving up, you know, one or two odd kills here or there, but map control regained. Maybe it does look like they want another Baron. Super Minion's still in the bottom lane, in that middle lane. It's going to be easily secured. And there's not a lot Gambit can do, I'm afraid. Their opportunity to contain and control Millenium has actually passed.
40 seconds until that Baron comes up, and it will take, I think you're right there, a monumental mistake from Millenium at this point to lose on this 10,000 gold lead that they've managed to build themselves up. And look at this, Kerp waiting inside the Death Brush, and pretty much whoever comes towards that one, whether it's 1v1 or not, Kerp is probably going to win out on that battle. As I said before, QSS is available to him should he end up getting a little bit locked up. And there we see it, the Baron about to spawn in. Millenium already sat there and waiting. They're going to take this one down. But Gambit are actually going to try and come across, but honestly, they're going to be too slow, number one. There's Destiny actually used. Not going to make a difference whatsoever. Millenium get the second Baron of the game.
Too little, too late. Millenium going to set their sights on the top lane, get a big minion wave to work with, and Darian's doing a decent enough job shoving out the super minions in the bottom lane, which will buy a tiny amount of time for Gambit to make use of. But again, Millenium have tower dived before. They're going to tower dive again. If Gambit are not grouped up together as a five-man defensive unit, then Millenium will just punish that. Millenium will jump in. You know what? Even if there are five members of Gambit, I still think Millenium will want to dive in.
Yeah, I don't think they're too afraid at this point. Kevin got the tankiness, got the damage in there as well. Be a real threat as the Q gonna land on towards Genja. Karnak couldn't quite get behind him. Will tank up a couple of turret hits, but that regen will just bring him straight back to full HP here by the time that next wave starts to come through. That won't be too much of a problem for Millenium. Here they go then, moving forward. Diamond is going to move in there and try to do some damage. Didn't actually use his ultimate for quite a while on that one. Gives him the shield, but not too much pushed in the way of Millenium.
No, ultimate is now not available for Diamond, so if he does get caught or go in, he's going to be much less. Now, super minions are going to be bashing away, or rather, siege minions in the bottom lane in him. And Millenium are just playing this game super patiently. They may have caught Darian.
Yeah, Genja's actually gone away from this one, and there's the burst. Two of them at least gonna fall from this. Darian will leap away, and now Nick, the next focus. Look at that damage from Kerb. He will actually get shut down by Genja, who came back in. But that is the third and final inhibitor gonna go down. The bottom inhibitor has been done for them pretty much here with those minions, and that will go down as well. So all three inhibs down. This is surely Millenium gonna win the game. They push through. Darian gets knocked out. There's four men left alive for Millenium, although Cotonex is very, very low. Nick and Genja, the only two left to maybe hold on to this one. But look at those Enix turrets. The Nexus turrets. And they do dive onto Genja in the end. Nick going to be the next target.
Wow.
The ace for Millenium. As the Nexus turrets go down, the Nexus itself will, of course, follow. And Millenium pick up a very impressive win over Gambit Gaming.
They go 2-0 on the week. And just such exciting play. That was the definition of a pick comp. Single target dashes and movement and mobility, and just punishing over and over and over. Any single time Gambit showed any moments of weakness, Millenium just punished it. It was a very exciting game to watch, but that Baron should not have been so easy for Millenium.
And it's not the first time that we've seen Gambit make these questionable positioning decisions where one person who's not Darian, who has a teleport, goes to clear out the bottom wave or just to get the CS down there. We've seen just a couple of weeks ago Genja doing wraiths and getting caught out, which led to an enemy Baron. They really need to fix that. They can't afford to not have their AD carry there for a fight. There wasn't even a fight, was there? Because they were just nowhere near it.
At 35 minutes, when you have a top laner that has teleport available, you've sent the wrong person to that side lane farm. It is actually something that we have criticized Genja of many times in the past, of being on those side lanes. And it was the Baron that really tipped the game completely in Millennium's favor. They had control, but it wasn't absolute control. And once they had that Baron, they were just super confident. They forced the towers, they tower dove, and it was a convincing win for Millennium in the end.
Yeah, impressive stats by the end of it. 25 to 10 in kills. There was a 16,000 gold lead for Millennium coming out. So looking very, very good. I remember at the start of yesterday, we talked about both Millennium and Gambit in terms of their consistencies. Now, Gambit have shown once again that they are probably the most inconsistent team in the entire league. However, Millennium, I think, answering those critics somewhat, going 2-0 against two very, very good teams in the league right now.
I agree with you, and I actually think if you look at Millennium holistically, in terms of all of the games that they have played, the average level is high. They've had games where they've lost. They've had games that have been beaten. But you can attribute that to their opponents playing superbly.
Yeah.
And sometimes you have a bad game. You know, you can't be the absolute best all the time. And for Millennium, I actually think they're in a good position as this league continues to roll on because they're showing a very good style of play. I said this yesterday when they won. I'm going to say it again. They only do well with pick compositions. We have not seen them win through split pushing necessarily. We've not seen them win through 5v5 team comps. They play single target burst compositions. And they do them well. But I do think it's worrying because if people know how to counter that, they may not pick up as many wins.
And we've seen those losses as well when they've had a similar type of comp, when they've had similar champions. We talked about Fizz before we started this game. 1-1 for Kerp, one very good game, one terrible game, let's call it. This one was a very good game for him. He ended 8-2-8. You know, probably could have avoided even those two deaths in the grand scheme of things, but really, really well done. Creighton as well, we've been a little quiet on him, I think, in the last couple of weeks, but he said at the start of the season, motivation's there, and he's playing like the Creighton of old before the broken arm.
Completely agree. He's definitely upped his game. I do just want to call Kerp out very quickly because he is on my flex pick on my fantasy team, and he didn't get 10 kills or 10 assists. So we're going to have words after this because I need to beat Rivington this week.
Well, boo, boo for you. Well, guys, we are going to head over to Shox and Deficio, who are standing by with Millennium's Jayri.
Thank you very much, Joe. Indeed, standing by with Jayri, talking about that win. And we're going to talk a whole lot about Braum, obviously. Let us start first about priorities, because we've seen it banned out a lot of times. So how high up the list was he for you guys? And what did you want to build around it or fit Braum into?
For us, Braum is not really like first pick material. But since they didn't pick it, we just pick it from them.
And what is it exactly he does as a champion? Of course, you're the support here. You should know everything about him. So tell us.
He's like very heavy CC champion, like Leona, but range poke and the ranged ultimate. So he's really strong.
And what happened in the laning phase then? Because he's so strong, yet you guys actually fell behind against Genja and Edward here. What went wrong?
We misplayed the early game and they got level 2 first. Then we could never really come back after that. So yeah, we were just behind.
Well, you say you just picked them, but it seemed like in team fights that you knew exactly what to do. And we're actually going to take a replay. We're going to bring it up on the screen so you can talk us through it, because it shows very well what Braum is so good at in those team fights.
Yeah.
So we just rolled a clip, of course, and we will see what happens. Coach Ree on Braum here. Talk us through it.
Yeah, I just missed my Q. Then ultimate Genja gets a knock-up. Then I just block the curling with my shield, so I take no damage. And then we just catch Edward with Kerp.
And I assume obviously this was the whole idea behind your comp. You would catch our targets, land first a passive from you, and then multiple members would go in and land a stun, and you have all the single target damage we see here.
Yeah, no. Now it's basically clean up after we got the first two kills.
All right, so as you said, it wasn't going so well in that laning phase. Now that you played Braum for the first time, you decided to pair it up with Graze against a Lucian and a Thresh. Why this and why against that matchup, and why would you like to play it with?
I prefer to have Lucian because it's so easy to proc the passive, but since they picked it, we just went with Graves.
Yeah, well, it absolutely worked out, and great to see Braum in action, of course. We also asked you guys at home something at the top of the show. We asked you to tweet and let us know which team do you think has the strongest map control in the European LCS and why. And here are some of your answers. The first one is from @DownpourStar. Fnatic, when they play as a team like yesterday, they are unstoppable. I saw shades of the old Fnatic.
I agree. I mean, also just with the fact they picked up four sweeping lenses very early on in the game yesterday, denied all the vision, and just kept finding targets in the jungle, had some good wards as well. So I agree, once they actually play their game correctly, they are still very strong, and also the map pressure, because the map focus is very good for them.
Jerry, your opinion on playing versus Fnatic?
They are really annoying to play against because they barely do any mistakes. So yeah, they're really annoying to play against.
The second tweet is from @ParaCrankster. I think Alliance has better map control this compared to the last split. Alliance show a lot of potential heading to London.
So I agree it's better than last split, but we actually saw yesterday they had a few issues against Gambit where they lost all the dragons, couldn't really find the right team fights. According to them, of course, it was due to a bad comp. So you see what they play against Fnatic today, but I agree as a team they play a lot better and they have a lot more focus on generally wards. Every time I talk with Froggen, it's like wards, 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 and Nivea, wards, wards. And so obviously, they have pretty good map pressure.
Yeah, Jerry, also must be a big difference playing against Alliance now and last split.
Yeah, they're also really annoying to play against. Like, once they get ahead, they just place wards in the whole jungle and then you're screwed, basically.
There's not a lot you can do. Well, of course, we'll see both Fnatic and Alliance face off in just a minute. But for you guys, thank you for those tweets. And remember that you can send your questions and answers to us at LOL Esports and use that hashtag LCS. We need to head to the base to upgrade our trinkets, but we'll be right back with Fnatic versus Alliance.
Graves, Braum, how is that lane?
Manly.
Manly. Oh, it's good.
Genja.
He's dead.
He's dead.
Nice.
I got to
nice.
Behind.
Nice.
Look mid.
I'm running.
No flash.
A slow. Go from here.
Nice. We're coming. I'm coming.
I got there.
I slow there.
Kill him.
Standing for me, I want to kill.
Nice!